Good afternoon, everybody. Or I'm sorry, good morning, everybody. I'm just so excited to be here. My name is Susan Goldberg. I'm the editor-in-chief of National Geographic magazine and the editorial director of National Geographic Partners. And we are here today to talk about what everybody's talking about these days, which is gender. Gender roles and how that is playing out around the world. And I have two wonderful experts that I will introduce. But first, I just wanted to point out on the screen, this is the January issue of National Geographic, and it is called Gender Revolution. There are actually two different covers. This is the one that went to our subscribers, and this is the one that we are selling on the newsstand. Showing a range of people who are describing themselves and describing their gender in different ways. You know, bi-gender, non-binary, transgender, and pretty much everything in between. Gender has really become one of the topics that's getting discussed. You've got people like Caitlyn Jenner bringing this to the forefront, but what we try to do in National Geographic magazine and what I'd like to do today is talk about really how gender plays out in the lives of just ordinary people, not movie stars in evening gowns on magazine covers, but just the lives of ordinary kids and how families and teachers and legislatures at all levels of government are trying to deal with this issue. So let me introduce the people I've got here to talk about this. On the far side here, this is Xing. She is sort of the Oprah Winfrey of China. She has a talk show. I think it's just celebrated its 100th episode. She gets about 100 million viewers a week in China. And in 1995, Xing became the first transgender woman to receive government approval to undergo a gender reassignment surgery, and has been living as a woman since 1995, yes. And we'll talk about that today. Right next to me, this is Eric Vilain. Eric is a geneticist and pediatrician who directs the UCLA Center for Gender-Based Biology, and a lot of his work has focused on intersex people. So I thought I would just start out with you, Xing, and maybe tell us about your journey and your story.
Okay, some people maybe from different channels get my stories. Xing Xing, born in 1967, this year 50 years old. My professional as a dancer. I'm a professional classical ballet dancer since 9 years old as a young boy. And in the 70s, that's why people asking, where did you receive all the dance training in the Chinese military? Because in China, we adopt this system from 50s, from Soviet Union. Best dancer, best athlete, all training by the military. So 9 years old, I was chosen by the government and put him in the military dance school, start my dance career. I'm still dancing. Today I'm here, Thursday night I'll be dancing in Singapore.
Oh, you're still
dancing? I'm still dancing. I have my dance company. Also, 1999, I found the first modern dance company in China.
Okay.
Also, was before I changed my sex, 1988, before China had no contemporary dance, no modern dance. Under American-China exchange program, I was sent by the government to the United States to learning modern dance with all the great masters like Martha Graham, Paul Taylor, Harvey Nicholas. So also, same time I discovered the world of modern dance, and same time I discovered myself, my gender. I know myself clearly as to be a woman when I was 6 years old, a child. I have an older sister, 4 years older than me. And that time I look at my sister, I said, something wrong with me, but I don't know what it is. But I keep this quietly. Then luckily, I love the stage, but dance chose me. I become a stage person as a dancer. So through the dance, I discovered myself more and more and more. When I was 19, went to the United States learning a modern dance, then I decided, okay, now I have to become myself, change myself, find the right time, become a woman who I am. So I, from 19 years old until 28, I wait. For 9 years, every day I asking myself question, are you ready? Are you sure you are the woman? You are yourself. Then I'm positive. Even today, a lot of people ask me, during the whole 28 years in the male's world, are you frustrated? I said, no, I'm not frustrated. I just confused. I don't know when will be happen. I just waiting for the moment. So then I, 28 years old, I can take full responsibility to myself. Then I did a change in China, in Beijing. Of course, in 1995, sex change in Beijing, in China, is a big taboo. Besides of that, I was the first modern dancer of China. Best male dancer become a best female dancer. It's too much for China. Too much, that time is too much. But I think, okay, I made this. People ask me, why you go back to China to sex change instead of in Europe? That time I already work in Europe, in Belgium, Brussels. Then I said, somehow I'm a very expeditious person. I want, first life my mother gave me is Chinese. Second time I gave myself a birth, still need China. So I went back to Beijing, I did my change.
So that was 1995, and then since then you have remained in the public eye and...
Yes, then I constantly changing, challenging the Chinese society. After that, I found the first modern dance troupe, which was private owned, without any government subsidized. Modern dance company, and after that 2000, I from Beijing, I moved to Shanghai, then adopted three orphans. I become a single mother with three kids.
Okay.
That's also challenging for Chinese society. Transgender, best male dancer, become a female dancer, find the first modern dance company, and that's why I quickly, my stories. Then year 2000, when I moved to Beijing, to Shanghai, I talked to my friend. I said, one day if China TV allow have a talk show, I'll be the talk show person. After 15 years, I did it. 2015, I launched my talk show in China 2 years ago. Now, just like Susan said, it's a top viewed talk show in China. So many, but I'm still considering myself as a dancer, I'm an actress. I'm still dancing on stage with my dance company. Also every week I'm acting on stage as a theater performer. So this thing's changing. And 2004, I met my husband. 2005, I married to a German gentleman who's sitting there behind with me. Yes, we are happily married. And with the three children. Then after 1 year, we get divorced. Very tricky story. Oh. Because I'm adopted three children, so I need to put all the kids under my name. But with a foreign marriage, it doesn't work. Only way I come back my single mother position, then I divorce with him, put all my kids on my name.
But you're still together.
We're still together.
That's good.
The love always there. We don't care
Excellent.
About the papers. We don't care about the papers.
I'm beginning to feel like Oprah myself here.
Yes, yes.
All right. So, but Eric, let me...
Stories.
So, let me ask you. So, this is an amazing journey. You are working with families and kids and studying what's going on all the time. What do you do when there's a six-year-old child? Like, this is Avery Jackson. She's 9 years old in this picture. Ever since she was four, she said, I'm a girl. And as you can see, her quote there is, the best thing about being a girl is now I don't have to pretend to be a boy. So here's a young person who knew very, very early on who she was. What do you say?
Right. Well, it's, of course, very difficult because you come, like myself, in a sense as an outsider to these children and this family. They're living it. I'm caring for them. I'm a pediatrician. I care for children who are born intersex, also caring for children who are who have gender nonconformity. Like,
tell people what intersex is.
Oh, intersex means just that they're born with genitals that you can't tell whether they're boys or girls, and those situations happen much more often than we think they do. It's about 0.5 to 1% of the population that has some degree of atypicality of the genitals. So it's quite frequent. Nobody talks about it, but it's something that happens a lot in families all over the world.
And we'll get back to that in a minute.
So, the question you're asking, Susan, about what to do, especially when the children are saying, well, I am a girl if it's a natal boy, or I am a boy if it's a natal girl. The difficulty is to actually not necessarily go on with the story and say, well, of course you are a girl. I think what we know, and then I'm taking sort of the scientist perspective, not denying the individual experiences, but if you look at what happens to these children, most of these boys who say, I am a girl, as they go through puberty, at some point, most of them, not all of them, but most of them will desist, meaning they will not say anymore, I am a girl. They will be comfortable with being a boy, and they will turn out to be gay men, often effeminate gay men, but they will be comfortable with their gender identity. Depending on, there has been more than 10 studies about that, showing that that's sort of the natural history, that's the path.
Although there are a lot of people in the transgender community who would disagree very strongly with, right. with what you just said.
They would disagree because they're saying, well, that's not has been that, that has not been my experience. True, there might be part of these 10 to 20% who actually persisted in
like Jim.
Absolutely.
Yes, I do have confused time between 12 years old until 15, 16. That time I confused myself. I said, maybe I'm homosexual. I'm gay. Then I tried to, then later on I discovered, no, completely different feelings. Then I still come back to myself, like 6 years old, I say, I should be the girl, I should be a woman. Then that's from 19 years old, very clear.
Right. Yeah. And in China, when you was there a lot of, I would say, homophobic pressure, a lot of pressure against gay people?
It's funny things. Homosexual issue, transgender is transsexual issue, this kind of idea culturally, actually, in China culture, where it existed many, many hundred years ago, we just don't talk about it. Mm-hmm. Recently, I think after China opened to the world, I think from the 80s, I can get a lot of information from Western world, and we discovered that a lot, so many things in the Western world, everything must be labelized, gay, homosexual, lesbian, everything. Before China, we don't talk about it, just everything on the table, let it be, how they can, but not on the tables, above the table, people get a little bit hesitant to talk about these issues, yeah.
I mean, looking at what happens in different countries, it seems that in countries where there is a lot of repression against homosexuality, the rate of transgender individuals actually increases. Mm. So a good example is countries like Iran, where young gay men get hanged if they come out as homosexual. Not all of them, of course, but it's been sort of a public display, like this is a sin, this is bad. And sort of one solution out of this is if they do change gender, then it becomes a much more accepted behavior, because now the real sin being same-sex sexual relation, now that is not happening anymore because they've switched gender. So it's kind of it's interesting because it conflicts a little bit with this idea that I am a girl when they're little boys. It's just social circumstances push people in one direction rather than another. Just to finish in the question of what to do when those children mm-hmm. come, you know, my tendency is to say, well, you can, if you're a little boy, you can do anything you want that looks like feminine, stereotypically feminine. When you're a little girl, you can do anything you want that looks like what boys would typically do. You can, you know, wear a dress if you're a little boy. You can, you can do ballet, etc. But that does not necessarily mean that you are a girl. I think sort of, and very often children conflate how they behave and who they are, and it's very, very difficult for a child.
Well, I think we conflate that too. I mean, if you look at how society is, your gender identity and your sexual orientation are often conflated. I mean, sexual orientation mm-hmm. is who you're attracted to, and gender identity is who you are. And the picture I just put up, now these are identical twins, mm-hmm. and this comes out of one of the stories we did. This is Caleb on the left and mm-hmm. Emmy on the right, and they live in Massachusetts. When they were born, you really couldn't tell them apart. Just a few months ago, Emmy, the girl, underwent gender reassignment mm-hmm. surgery. Mm-hmm. And so you've got these identical twins who right. really have chosen these very, very different mm-hmm. paths. Do you see something mm-hmm. like that very often?
Right. So we see that for sexual orientation, and we see that for gender identity. Roughly, it's when one twin is gay or transgender, the other twin will be gay or transgender only in about 50% of the cases. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of interesting because they're genetically identical,
right?
And yet the outcome is completely different. So it must be something. You can say, oh, well, gender identity is influenced by things that are other than genetic, than biology.
I would ask Shin, what do you think about that? I mean, where do you think? All right, so you always felt like you were a
yes, but
girl.
I think so. We have a three gender issues for each person. When you're born, the biological gender was your parents gave to you as a boy or girl. That's biological; you cannot change. And after that, I think slowly you've grown up by all the information putting on to you. Then you start thinking you psychologically. You commit yourself: are you a woman or man? And also third gender is from society. You want society take you as a man or woman. I think for me, I'm thinking this way, then I put myself, of course, biologically I born as a boy, but inside psychology, inside my sexual orientation, also I want the society look at me as a woman. So this two against the one, I'm very clear for that. And also Chinese culture is, when the kids are young, before 5 years old, Chinese family don't identify too much about the kids of male or female, they can play both. The girl, boy can dress like girl. The parents think, oh, it's cute, sweet.
Oh.
And the girl dress naughty, fine. From after that, getting the school, society have a much more identical eyes on the kids. You are a boy, you should behave like a boy. Your girl should be like, slowly make the gap. But before that, very uncle, also family take that. I was very lucky. When I was learning dancing 9 years old, until 15, one of my best teacher, she's almost 85 years old, people, oh, that time I was a young boy. After I finished my boys' training, I escaped to the girls' room. I learned girls' movement. And everybody's thinking, why is this boy learning a girl's steps? Because I was fascinated by the girl's steps. And the teacher said, just leave him alone. This boy have no gender clear up yet. Just leave him alone, give him a free. I was so thankful for my teacher. She just let me go. Then I was learning boys' step and girls' step, everything. Then when I decided to changing, then my teacher said, see, that's it. She found herself.
That's so interesting. I mean, and certainly for those of us in Western cultures, a little surprising. I mean, I think things have changed, but still, don't you think, Eric, that most kids are, if you're a boy, you're supposed to be acting like a boy, and if you're a girl, you know, you're supposed to act like a girl.
Right, although there is much more tolerance for little girls to act like boys, because
tomboy, which is actually, although you don't hear that as much as now as you used to.
No, 2002. Sorry, that is not 2002. I did a dance piece with a German artist. We did a duet called "Person to Person." In this piece, we talk about which movement certainly belong to the boy, which movement belong to the woman. That's why in Chinese culture, after girl become 6, 7 years old, the family teach the girl how to sit in properly like this. Your leg, you're not like, oh, spell your leg. Before that, fine, let it go. Let it natural. But after that, you get from the movement gesture, the child, girl must behave like this. And they give muscle space for the boys.
Yes.
But what we find from a biological perspective is that the way people behave in a more stereotypical feminine fashion or in a more stereotypical masculine fashion is more likely to be pushed by some biological determinants, meaning that there is some biology, nothing is ever 100%, but there is some biology pushing girls or boys to behave differently. Mm-hmm. The reason we know that is because when we look at children born intersex, and we can look at what's different from, say, a girl that was born after being exposed to very high levels of male hormone, testosterone.
In the womb.
In the womb, okay. So there is a condition called congenital adrenal hyperplasia, CAH, in which that happens. These girls are born girls. They're raised as girls. And you can look at their toy play preference, for instance, which is a classic psychological test. They will spend much, much more time with male types of toys. You can say, oh, well, that's all society that just basically says this is a male toy or this is a female toy. Very true. However, if you do the experiment with little monkeys, young monkeys, male monkeys, and female monkeys, and you give them a little, which I had a picture to show that, a little car versus a little cuddly teddy bear, the female monkeys will cuddle the teddy bears. Mm-hmm. And the male monkeys, statistically, okay? So there is something biological there. You can say, No, it's all society. But
the, I think of us who've been around children enough, you do see boys gravitating to, or many boys gravitating to different kinds of toys and games than girls, and where that comes from, I'm not sure.
So the gender role has some biological determinant. The gender identity, on the other hand, it's much more fluid, it's much more complicated, there is much more social determinants
to that. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about that, and this picture I just put up, this is taken in Samoa, and this is a group of people called the Fafafine, and they really are considered a third gender. And there is a number of places around the world where there is a third gender. I think even in certain Native American tribes, there's a third gender, small. So how does that come about?
What you're saying is very true. Is, you know, the Berdash in the Native Americans, the Fafafines in the Samoa, the Mushes in some regions of Mexico like Oaxaca. So they're all around the world. You have this sort of third gender. What happens is, I don't see it personally as that different from what happens in the rest of the world, in the sense that there are some boys or girls, but in most cases it's boys who behave in a more stereotypically feminine fashion. But what happens in these societies that are in fact quite tolerant, they are sort of considered as some kind of a protected different gender. And it's, they're just seen differently, and they're being labeled by the society as a third gender. But I don't think there is that much difference between the young boy Fafafine in the Samoa who are behaving like a girl, who will become then they will wear dresses, and they will
their whole lives beyond childhood.
I'm not sure it's that different from what happened to.
I don't know, Jin, what do you think? I mean, do you think there's, a third gender, or?
I think the third gender idea, everybody has it. Then how much the space and society give you space to developing it.
Okay.
Even for women, everybody, you're doing certain things in the male's way. Even today, when I'm directing a show with 200 artists on stage, the way I'm talking and people say, oh my God, she still behaves like a man. I said, no. I said, give me a break. That's a quality. What do you behave like a man? I said, I need that quality to guide 200 artists working together. Who said that's kind of straightforward as belong to males? But then certain part, with my husband, with my kids, I'm mother of three, and people said, my God, which one is real her? I said, we're me, I know. But in society, we perform at different stage, different platform, that's developing it. And kids like this, of course, through the dancing, through the behavior, he feel more comfortable with himself. That's what's developing, become a third gender. Maybe biologically, male or female, but psychologically, what's driven to them to behave and to let the society accept it, that's more strongly appeared. Now the society must open and tolerant. Like in China, the homosexual, if you don't harm other people, you don't harm the society, and people just let it be, just be yourself. You don't do the outrageous things against other people's the life value or attitude, that's fine. Yeah.
So in China, you think people are getting more accepting of a range of, or of a gender fluidity, if you will?
Much better than the 30 years ago, before people are sensitive. But also, I think both ways. In a way, we are much more tolerant. But in another way, the space much more narrow. I can give you an example. Before China opened, before the 80s, we don't talk about the homosexual, or don't talk about gender issue. Everything has to stay there. And you can often see two boys holding a hand walk on the street. Even you can see two soldiers on the vacation, holiday time, two soldiers holding a hand walk on. People thinking they are good friends, they are buddies. Now these days, you see two boys holding a hand, people immediately say, are they gay or whatever? This kind of labelize actually make life much more sensitive and complicated.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Before you two boys come home after hanging out, stay in one room, parents have no second thought. Now, if you have a boy to stay in one room, the Chinese parents say, oh my God, what's the matter with my boy? To sleep with his body in the room? No. This kind of sensitive issue become very relevant. So I think that's a society changing in the two directions. One way is more uptight. One way, okay, more understandable.
Very interesting. Yeah. Very interesting. So this picture that I just put up, now, this person, Hunter Keith, who's 17 years old, was born female, assigned female at birth. but always felt like a boy since the fifth grade. And by seventh grade, he told his friends that, and by eighth grade, he told his parents that he was a boy. And just 2 weeks before this picture was taken, Hunter had his breasts removed, and now he can skateboard without his shirt on. And you know, he is a really interesting young man who's made, you know, I think a pretty big decision at a young age. When is the right age if somebody is going to make this kind of decision? Jin waited till she was 28. This person has waited to 17 to at least start down that road. Is there a right age when you think you can do that?
Well, I appreciate what Jin said about waiting. I think, I mean, I'm not going to come up with a number because I think it would be silly.
Yeah.
But certainly, I think sometimes too young is too young. And there is a tendency in certain parts of the United States or in Europe to now socially transition these boys or girls very early if they just express something that's a little gender non-conforming.
Although isn't the rule persistent, insistent, and consistent, right? Those are if the kid says, I'm a girl or I'm a boy, persistent, but insistent, consistent.
Yeah, but for how, that's right. The question is, as I said earlier, you can say, you can do whatever you want, that doesn't necessarily mean that you are a boy or a girl. Let's just wait and see.
Yeah.
So now the problem with the I get a lot of critiques for this attitude, which is to say, oh, what about the suffering,
right,
the psychological suffering? And you know, it's a complicated balance. I like to be sort of in the middle and maybe piss off everyone, but it's because at the end of the day, the question is, you know, if you socially transition early these kids, it's a life that's a little bit more complicated.
It
it's a life that you will have body modification.
Yes.
You will have hormone replacement therapy or hormone therapy for the rest of your life.
If you wait till puberty,
Right. There is a medicalization of this. It's just, it's problematic, you know, in a sense. So you can, as I said, the majority, if you let it go and wait until you agree to do these changes, maybe around puberty, at least, then there is a decent chance for the vast majority that there will be no need for actual transition.
Mm-hmm.
And without all these body modifications that are significant and irreversible.
And so I just put up another picture. Now this is Trinity, and when she was four, she basically stopped talking and started chewing on her boy clothes. She was born a boy, and said that she wanted to cut off her penis. And her parents were understandably alarmed and took her to a therapist. And the therapist said to them, "Do you want a happy little girl or a dead boy?" And so Trinity's mother, who is a fierce advocate, they ended up putting her on puberty blockers. She's now 12 years old. So, and apparently she is the first minor in Delaware to be covered for this treatment by Medicaid. It does seem like this is working its way into society.
It is working its way. There is use of puberty blockers that have not been looked at in long-term outcomes. I mean, there is a lot of, you know, I think we're playing with a lot of dangerous things without actually doing the appropriate research to see who, at the end of the day, because that's what matters to me, who's going to have a good quality of life, depending on the choices that are made. And I think there is a lot of political push to say, yeah, okay, the child says, I'm a X, then let's just go this way without, and if the parents start questioning it, they're just seeing as bad parents. And I think the reality is a little bit more complicated.
Oh, it's incredibly complicated. I mean, one of the things that we found is that this is certainly not going to go away as a topic. There was just a poll done of 1,000 millennials, and half of them, half of the young people polled said that they thought that gender was a spectrum, and a certain number of people are going to fall outside that binary boy-girl. And so if that's the mindset of millennials, or a lot of millennials, then it seems to me this is going to be a big ongoing.
And also, so another thing is the social influence. Because I clearly remember when I do the sex change surgery, another young boy also do the sex change next door. I asked him, why you do this? Are you sure yourself? He said, yeah, I think after I become a woman, life must be easier. I said, what do you mean life must be easier? Could be tougher. She said, no, I just married to a man, and I can dress beautifully, and that's it.
Oh, yeah.
Then I said, no, it's not simple like that. Right. That's why a lot of, some of the cases in China, after they did the sex change, actually they are gay psychologically. They think it become a woman, easier to get in touch with a man. All life must be easier. This complete wrong concept of this as a social influence. And after that, some people cannot take it, they can suicide later. And this kind of case very often.
And that is one of the distressing things of the higher rates of suicide, of violence against transgender people, of and that is this picture right here. I think they are far more likely to suffer domestic violence, violence on the street, sexual assault, every which kind. This is a transgender transgender person who has been suffered violence, and I'm looking, don't have my caption, but I think this was taken in, not the United States, but go ahead.
No, I was going to say, just reinforce what you were saying, that there is a lot of discrimination against transgender individuals.
Jamaica, sorry.
There is a lot of bullying at school, there is increased mental health issues, depression. There is also a number of health risks that are taken from addiction, cigarette smoking, HIV. You know, in larger American cities, the rate of HIV in Latina and African American transgender population is 50%. So it's very, very high in the transgender population in big inner cities. Even in healthcare settings, there's a lot of discrimination. Some doctors would say, go somewhere else, I don't know anything about this. So it's not an easy life. Employment discrimination is extraordinarily high. Only 16 states of the United States and the District of Columbia ban employment discrimination against transgender individuals, so it's a small minority.
And you've got a patchwork of laws across the world as to whether people are even allowed to have operations to transition. This is Trina, and this is taken in Jamaica. And you know, she's a sex worker, but she has been attacked, as you can see, with acid, knives, a machete, and a gun. And this is not, unfortunately, atypical for what can happen to transgender.
But
transgender
in my case,
people.
I was then at the day I out of the hospital. I got a lot of disagreement and prejudice. I know that. But that's why I have a very famous sentence in China. I talk to people, I say, if you understand what I'm doing, I appreciate it. I say, if you don't understand, I say, forget it, next life.
You know,
I think that's a and also, same time I remember, when I come out of the hospital, one of the well-known filmmaker, director, he looked at me, and one day, he's talking spontaneously, but without the intention, he said, how come person like you living so well? You know, that's kind of sentence. I said, why not? I asked him directly, why not? A person like me, and what's wrong with me? Then that's why actually gave me a lot of pause to encourage myself, make it better. That's why 10 years ago, I went and said I opened a talk show in China. Everybody saying, don't dream about it. Jinxing, which your background, transgender, forget it. This China never happened. I said, wait, will be happen. So that's when today I became most popular TV host in China. Then I convinced with my dedication to the life. And that's give a lot of young people. If you're asking me, do I involve any activities about homosexuality?
Yeah.
I said, no. I said, the attitude turning to this already give a lot of young people all kind of chosen life attitude deserve equal respect. That's why in China today, everybody talk, okay. And a lot of young people, China, look at me and said, I make my own decision without harm nobody, no society. Why should not deserve any equal respect? That's the issue raising up in China today.
But you can't. You don't think that you could, say, talk about this young person. Mm. This is Jonathan, who is 8, who identifies as both a boy and a girl at the same time since he's been 2.5. Mm. And this is taken in a place that is much more accepting than the last picture that we saw. This is taken at California's Bay Area Rainbow Day Camp, mm. where kids can safely express their gender identities. And here he is pretending he's a unicorn as well. So, but that would not be something that you could talk about on your show. That would not be.
No, in China, that's why I was celebrating with my talk show team. 2 weeks ago, we did a 100 episode in China. We have a talk a lot of the social issue about the relation, education, kids, family, emotion. This we can talk a lot. A lot of barrier I cannot touch. It's very sensitive. But I think how we can survive, I was amazed. And also, you know, Chinese TV industry very demanding. Usually internationally, like opera talk show, it went to like a 40 minutes, 35 minutes. But in my talk show, I have to hold on to 70 minutes every Wednesday night. That's a lot of information to discuss, talk about. But the interesting things, you have seen so many things can talk about and a lot of discriminations, but you know the Chinese Twitter? We don't have a Chinese Twitter, we call the microblog. You know, they're sending messages. Every day, now I'm every day, I have 11 million followers on my Chinese Twitter.
That's a lot more than me.
No, but because the populations. Then I'm talking this, like soft media. You tell things through the media, through the talk show, everything. That's why people give a lot of idea about what we can talk about it today. But very sensitive, it's tough.
It is very sensitive. Mm. So speaking of talking, I did want to open this up, and I've got a couple of other questions that we got here from a Facebook Live session, but just wondering if there are any questions here from the audience.
Hi.
Oh, wait, microphone is coming to you. Hang on one second. If you could just say who you are.
Hi, Helen Joyce. I'm the international editor at The Economist. Thank you so much for a very sensitive and interesting discussion about these issues. I have a sort of fundamental question that I'd like to ask both the panelists and also you, having put together this great package for National Geographic. There seems to me to be a fundamental contradiction between the idea that gender is so important and so binary that somebody might need to actually take significant medication and also have surgery to switch from one bucket to the other, so to speak, and this idea that you mentioned from millennials, who 50% of them say gender is a spectrum, in which case we shouldn't need to be trying so hard to match our body to our behavior to our psychology.
That's a great point, and I think the millennials have it right in this case, because I think a lot of parts of the transgender movement is in fact seeing the world as very binary. I mean, if you look at the cover of Vanity Fair with Caitlyn Jenner, this is a picture of a woman that does not exist anymore. Who has the time to spend an entire afternoon to just paint your nails? And I mean, she's beautiful. But this is an image of a woman from the 50s who was just laying on her couch and doing absolutely nothing but make herself up, and I think a lot of feminists have a problem with this made up image of women that is just passé. So it's there is a push for binary in the transgender movement that actually goes against a lot of the feminist ideas. So, gender as a spectrum is probably the end, and it's more like gender role as a spectrum. I think it's, I think we should go to more of a post-identity world. It doesn't matter.
Well,
that's what the millennials are saying.
Well, you agree with Miley Cyrus, actually. So she says, and she's 20. She's 22, right? She says, mm-hmm. I don't relate to what people would say defines a girl or a boy, mm-hmm. she said in this interview with Out Magazine a couple of years ago. And she said, I think that's what I had to understand. Being a girl isn't what I hate. It's the box that I get put into, which is actually a very interesting interesting thing. I mean, it would sort of seem simpler or better, a better world if it were more.
I think that no,
less
listen,
judgmental, yeah. less labels, as you were saying.
Yes, I think so. Label I should be put on the side, and you must be feel comfortable. And in now these days, I think the unisexual idea, concept, I think work better in all the different areas. I think people, how do you define yourself? Or you go to the heart changing, so the medical, or you just stay yourself, but you clearly behave who you want to behave. This is most important. Then you want to dress a family, you want to dress like a man. That's just acceptable if you're comfortable with. But I think not this day society, we have still certain, even all the magazines, TVs, try to propagate all the things of what woman should be like this. This is a wonderful, beautiful woman, right. one kind right. of type. And men should be like this kind of masculine. This kind of thing still try to, you know, people try to find the balance. Yeah.
You know, I would just say two things. Mm. In putting together this issue, one of the things that we did at the very beginning of the issue was put in a glossary because it has become so difficult to even have a conversation about gender because no one even knows the terms to use. Mm-hmm. And everybody's afraid of saying something offensive. And what we tried to do was arm people with, here are words you can use to hopefully spark a thoughtful conversation. The other thing I'd add is that our photographer who took this picture is named Robin Hammond. And you know, he went all over the world. He interviewed 89-year-olds about the role that gender played in their lives. This is in eight countries all over. This is Avery, and she's in Kansas City. And she was the only transgender kid that he talked to. But he's gotten a lot of pushback for this picture because people say, oh, you dressed her up in all pink to show mm-hmm. she's a girl.
Right.
Well, just...
Very true.
Mm-hmm. She came to the door with pink hair, pink outfit. Right. I mean, this is her
caricature.
Choice. But I do think, so here's a boy who's now a girl, and I think she must want to wear what she thinks is a real girly outfit,
mm-hmm,
right?
Mm-hmm. It,
pink everywhere. And I, you know, that was the picture that Robin got.
But of course, it could have been a boy who does everything that girls typically do and remaining in boys' clothes. You know, that's,
it
you
is,
know, why is there this need
yeah.
to dress up in pink?
Well, this was the choice. Okay. Can I ask for any other questions or thoughts? Yes, ma'am.
Can
one wait for the microphone if you could.
Hi, I'm Sabine Bauer from Germany. I'm also a mother of three, and I also have twins, so that was an interesting picture for me as well, even though mine are not identical. I have a question. How important is the parents' influence? I mean, you mentioned this one boy who told the friends first and then the parents later. And how supportive are the parents? In your case, Xing, I was interested how supportive were your parents, even though you were older when you decided to change gender. And is that the very most important thing for you, or was it just your own decision, or were your parents also very helpful?
I'm very lucky point of view. I'm a lucky one. I always keep joking about this. I'm a fully respect the copyright. Who created me originally is my parents. I only ask their permission. If these two people in this planet, no problem, I have no problem with other people. So I talked to my mother. My mother always denied it. Because people asking, your boy 28 years old, never have a girlfriend, what's the matter, what's wrong, he's a gay? My mother said, no, he only pay attention to his dancing art. And one day I come up, I said, I want to change, become a woman. My mother didn't shock at all. My mother just said, are you sure? I said, yes. She said, she just said, whatever, man and woman, you're always my kids. I just want you to stay healthy and continue dancing. You're dancing so beautifully. I said, I try my best. I was worried about my father, very typical traditional Chinese man, military officer. I talked to him, I said, your boy will become girl. My father silent for 1 minute and take out a cigarette, for one cigarette, and he looked at me, he said, finally matched, congratulations.
Wow.
I said, why, you see
wow.
that? He said, when you're young, I would look at you, you are a little boy, but you behave like a little girl. I was wondering, I have a boy, but he behave like a little girl. After 28 years, you find yourself, congratulations. Even my father went to the local police, changed my identity card. Tell them,
oh,
say,
my.
My boy become my girl. And the local police station said, no, never happened. She said, yes, history start now.
What?
Change it.
What an amazing
So that's
amazing
why I was
story.
Very lucky. Even today, my mother, I am very fully supportive of who I am. the end, my mother said a very good sentence. She said, no matter boy or girl, you're always my kid. We just want you to be happy. This is your life. I think that's it. That speaks a lot about the parents. So with my kids, you know, I adopted three children, and with a such huge background mother, and now they are grown up, I just openly, since then they are 3 or 4 years old, they know exactly the three kids I adopted, and the mother was a man, and my son asked me, so why you become my mother? I said, if I don't become a woman, I cannot be your mother. The society doesn't allow it, because I love you so much, I was waiting for you too long, I have to become mother, then I can have you. Then fine, my three kids grown up beautifully and open up, even went to school, people said, oh my God, your mother's so famous. You know, she was a man. And my son said, so what? Mind your own business.
Yeah, very interesting.
8 years old, have a strong sentences. I think that makes life now beautiful. Yeah.
So Eric, you get the last word here on the role of parents in this, and just
Parents play a tremendous role. I mean, they're the key to success of the outcome. There's no question about it.
On whatever the outcome is.
On whatever the outcome is.
So what, supportive, loving,
supporting,
non-judgmental, is that what you're...
That's true, but they don't, again, they don't necessarily have to just, you know, go with everything their child says. If little Johnny says, I want to eat 10 pieces of chocolate before dinner, they'll say no. So I think parents still have, still put some boundaries, but they still may be loving. They have to be loving.
Mm-hmm. Well, that is where we're going to leave a very complicated, complicated set of issues. Thank you all so much for coming, and thank you to our panel.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah.